always check and sort of try and work around where the wheel's at. So I'll always try and level. First thing I know, if I get on side, if I can spin the wheel, then I know the machine was probably a little bit too high. If I found it a little quite tight, then I've got a pretty good chance that the machine's close to where it should be. But it's just a matter of leveling out the four corners of the machine. So I'll start by doing that. It's pretty easy. I always level on the most solid part of the cabinet, which will be on this front edge or the back edge. Try and avoid putting it here because there's a little bit of flex on the bow sheet. So this is usually the strongest sort of section. It always stays true for you. It's just a matter of working out where your level needs to be. So a little bit over to the left. And probably a little bit forward. Probably. Yeah. So I can pretty much adjust the back. I'll start with adjusting the back. It's pretty. Depending on these, some of these have actual lock nuts where there's a second nut. So once you adjust everything and get everything sweet, you can use a lock nut to lock the leg in place. And that will just stop them. These ones don't. The shade is like 50mm under door height shield. Is it door height about 2 meters? 1 meter. Okay, so I'm happy with that. Give it a little shimmy. I'd usually do this because even though you do get a level, there might be a little bit of a high spot somewhere, so I usually just give it a nudge and you'll sort of feel if there's a little bit of a rock, but that's pretty good. Alright. Still may need to adjust the inside door depending. But we'll wait and see if it's right on this. Pretty good. You should be able to, in the general rule, you should be able to pretty much get one of these lugs to go in by hand. It doesn't have to go in all the way, but at least you can catch a thread, then you know. Yeah, it's pretty good. The holes line up. You don't really need to adjust this. Tool usually is a Torx screw. They can be Phillips, but a lot of them are Torx, which is like a star-shaped Allen key. Mm-hmm. You can see that. They're a T25 usually. Most of the screws on the machine are T25. And it's very similar to I guess essentially it's like a jacking wheel, really. So these are just the lock screws that it's four lock screws here. Yeah, you can do that later. So you just loosen these lock screws out, and then I think it's a manual socket. This, fortunately, this machine we have a little bit of adjustability here with this, which is there. You will come across machines where these wheels are jacked and it's biased, so there's really no more jacking to get done on the door here. There is a few variations. It's just a matter of loosening the bolt, which lets the wheel come up, or jacking down the bolt, which pushes the wheel down and lifts the door. And you can see while you're jacking, you can see the bolt hole there, and you can actually adjust so it's nice and flush. Once you're happy with getting that sorted out, you just lock up these locking screws.
So Rod, if you find that it is fully adjusted, the wheel, you just lower the legs and re-level.
You're going to have to try and lower the legs or bring the leg up, or you know, essentially drop the machine and try and readjust the wheel. Most of the time, because they've already been outside or on a side or already set up in a warehouse, they'll be pretty close to where you want it to go. Might be a little bit of tweaking, but generally should be okay. And like I said before, it's one of the things with this machine is you sort of have to work around where that wheel is. There's a bit of a compromise there. It's just the way it is. Fortunately. So that's pretty much sweet there. Cool. So that's good. Probably going to take it down. That's great. That's what we want to see. Can't move it. The stock is. We try and load the machine up with stock right in the middle of it. That just helps avoid any mistakes later on and unnecessary work. The calibration area is up here in the machine and down the bottom of the machine. So,
what is it, 250 lines?
Three. 299.
299,
yeah.
X and Y is up and down.
It's a pretty smart concept on how they've done it. There's just a sensor that detects steel on the back of the cradle here. We call that the calibration sensor.
That's also adjustable too.
It is adjustable, and it's all part of how they've programmed the software. But what it's looking for is, you'll see these columns here, these steel columns of racks, DVD library or columns. You probably can't see them here, but there's a square cutout. You see? On each column. Up there. And down the bottom. And so what will happen as part of the calibration, once you start it, it will go looking for those holes. And it will zero in on calibration, which means it'll end up fine-tuning itself into where those columns are. And from that point on, you should be good. Once it finds those points,
starts doing its thing, you should be pretty much on the road to getting this machine set up. The thing to look out for is once you've like untaped stock, any blown out like this sort of pop, it's pretty important that you like that one down there. It just happens, you know, when you're untaping everything. Just gotta make sure that they're clipped in. Normally just rub my fingers down if anything sticks out. Clip it shut. And yeah, that's good. So pretty good condition DVDs. You may come across some with dog's ears, you know, where the sort of cases are all frayed up. Really, it doesn't really hamper the machine, it just makes a little bit of noise when you're putting DVDs in and out, because you've got the plastic noise sort of scraping each other as that robot there is moving DVDs in and out. Fire up the machine. Yeah, this is the new one, yeah. Yeah, new computer, I've never seen one of those in this
machine.
Yeah, make that. Yeah, a torch would be good. Oh, yeah. A torch is handy because you might get on some site where it's dark or it's in a bit of a enclave or whatever. And it's just good to have now, so you can see. Yeah, it can be difficult. Yeah, it's good. Yeah. It is a good way. Alright, so I'm just going to break out of this. So this is... So this is what customers will see. Just hit escape. The red toolbar. Tool
something. Some of those are like a dog or something.
Yeah, they call it a watchdog. Yeah. It's where a few people get stuck, so they've gone into their maintenance menu, but they're like, well, nothing's happening. You need to hit escape one more time.
It's easy to pause, isn't it?
It does, yeah. It's pretty common to skip or miss that detail. So straight away, this is the main menu of the machine. And these are the pages up the top here. The kiosk page is one of the pages that you'll use, and the calibration page is pretty much the other page that we'll use.
Okay.
Alright, so I'm going to lock the door up.
So because that's powered up right now, you're going to shut the door off?
Yeah, I'm going to run a calibration now, because that's pretty much the steps that we have to do.
So you're saying you leave the door open until it...
Until I get it to load up,
yeah,
and then when it loads up and I can get into this menu, which is the one that loads straight away, I'll then start a calibration. Okay. It's going to fail.
Yeah. You went back in there.
Yeah, I went in there. Yeah. Pick up
a little lugs.
And to fix the robot at the back,
yep.
What is that?
That's a cradle.
No, I mean like what's...
Oh, the calibration sensor.
What's the tool that you use to...
You can use a shifter, but it is a 17mm. But you guys, you could get away with the shifter. Yeah, you might need a dedicated tool for that.
Okay.
One bolt top, one bolt bottom. These things, these lugs, they don't need to be overly tight, they just need to be nibbed up. There's three bolts. If you nib them up,
just through them. You're not going to have much of a problem with the door coming from open or anything like that.
I'm going to hit the start calibration button. That's just a warning saying that it's detected stock in there already, but we know that we've moved the stock away from palm, so I'm just going to say yes and continue that.
Josh was saying something about 12 levels before, so if there's anything in those 12 levels, you've got to take out the DVDs there.
Yeah. Top and bottom, yeah. Yeah.
Otherwise it won't calibrate.
Yeah, it'll actually, it'll jam up. The robot will go in and there'll be stock there and it'll just jam and go into an error.
Once it all calibrates, that machine up, the stock in.
Yeah, wherever you want. You can put the stock back. Yeah.
Do we reposition the stock once it's calibrated through it?
If you've got like huge amounts of stock where you've actually had to pull it out and leave it out, right? So say you've got a full machine, totally full, you're going to have to remove that much and that much, put it in a shopping basket or a trolley or a box or whatever. And once you've done this, you're going to have to put it back. It doesn't matter where you put it back, just put it back.
But if it's like how it is now and we're doing the test, do we need to reposition anything?
No.
Or do we just walk away once you've passed the test? Yeah,
once it's passed the test.
The only thing you will need to do is wind that sensor back in so that when there is DVDs in that top and bottom 12 rows, the sensor's not hitting those DVDs. So that's the purpose of winding it in.
Yeah, it just avoids damaging everything. And once you've done this test, there's no reason for that sensor to be out anymore. So you just wind it back in. Yeah. It's failed. So it can't find point X. You'll see it'll come up in red on this little dialogue box. But I just showed you that just for the purpose.
So there's no set measurement with this.
It's about between 1.5 to 2 centimeters as a rule, but they vary a little bit. So it's usually, I just know because I've done it a million gazillion times. It's around that sort of amount sticking out. But it's better to go in a little, adjust in small increments out rather than just go out the whole way, because you'll end up, that sensor will end up hitting this column and chafing the sensor. You can probably see it's actually already had some damage. I don't know if you can see that. But there's a little chip on the bottom end. And that's what's happened. It's been rubbing against the steel column. It'll probably work, but if you keep doing it, it'll fail, and then, it'll be a service call, and, just more downtime.
Yeah.
Something that you want to try and avoid. All right, so that may still fail.
What was that?
Just as a note, there's an emergency stop button down here. That's handy to use if you're just not sure on anything, or if you're hearing it do some pretty crazy noises that shouldn't be doing. Just hit it, and it'll just stop any movement or anything that it's doing. Just saves, damaging the machine even more. All right, we'll kick this off again.
On a good day, how long should this take?
The calibration part.
Probably about 15.
15 minutes?
Yeah.
This part of it or the whole install?
Calibration. About 15,
That's what it's doing now.
15.
Yep.
And you can get to about 12 and a half minutes and then you fail.
Yeah, it's going to fail again.
So it doesn't tell you whether you're out or in.
No.
So you could be going the wrong way the whole time, then you're going to get
it. You'll know. Yeah, you'll know. Because if you've gone too far, you'll actually hear it rubbing on the column at the back. Yeah.
So you haven't gone far enough.
I haven't gone far enough. So I reckon probably another 2 mil would probably do it.
Okay. So normally, because in the warehouse, before we dispatch those kiosks, the calibration sensor should really already be out and enough because we've calibrated it in the warehouse as a test first. Yeah. So it should be fairly close to what you're going. It's probably.
This is worst case scenario.
Yeah.
But you're going to always for it inside. It's nice and smooth anyway. It's when you go under the path lines and you go.
Yeah, and it's probably, I think you'll find the most adjustment you'll need to make is when you're doing like a relocation. So it's come from Brisbane, for instance, and it's come from a site where it's had to be wound in, otherwise it's going to hit its DVDs and it'll get to you guys and it's wound all the way in. So you'll have to go through this process. So that's probably when it's going to take the most amount of time for you to get that right.
It's found a point, which is we're on a good pathway now. It may still fail because it has to go from the bottom to the top, and there might be a little bit of a difference between the top and the bottom.
Yeah.
So we'll see how it goes. If it writes a line across this table here, we know we're good, and it's failed. So I'm still going to have to come out a little bit more. I'm just going to avoid potential freezing, so I'm just going to reference it.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Go
back to calibration.
You should have been here last night.
Cold.
Yeah,
cool. Yeah. Cold. It's cold in my little park, isn't it?
It's lowlands.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The wastelands.
Yeah, it got 40 mil or so.
As I said, this is a worst case scenario. So this is when just nothing's working. It's good for you to know, just so you can refer back and look at it later. Yeah, I'm looking for, there's a cow sensor on off here, down here.
Yeah.
You probably won't need to look at it, but as a tech, that's what I look for. At least I know the cow sensor's working, it's reading.
Now, once you've done all this and you've got it all set up, you have to wind that sensor back in?
Ideally, yes. It just avoids any damage later on. Yeah.
Damage to the cartridges?
Yeah, I've seen catastrophic damage where for some reason the DVD's gotten caught vertically on that sensor. So it's been pierced like that, and the robot's just going around everywhere with the DVD stuck on it, and it's just literally almost destroyed the whole library. There's probably only like 20 cases that were salvageable, so the machine was like way down on titles and that.
Well, that's the importance of winding that sensor in beforehand.
It can do some massive damage. Because, yeah, steel on plastic is just going to kill it. Yeah, there's some damage that I still scratch my head about. Yeah. How did it even do that? I don't know. But one of those things.
You would think we'd reach a certain point of resistance or something.
It'll fail. Eventually it'll fail, but it's too late by then. You've already wiped half your stock out.
How many CDs over the period of time don't come back?
They do come back.
Yeah, but how many of them might
get damaged?
Oh, people don't return them?
Well, they get charged, don't they?
There's
they get charged, because it's all credit card.
Roughly how many?
Oh, I couldn't put a number to it. Yeah, I'm not sure. Oh, look, we do get quite a few people kind of getting to that max day period, which is at 10 days, but they get quite a hefty charge, and I think they don't really, they know that next time they're not going to do that again.
Here in the calibration table, it's written a line. So once you see that, there's a really good chance of finishing it. Yeah, success, and just finishing it off. So at this point, you just sort of have to sit and wait, do some paperwork, or make a phone call.
Have a coffee.
There's not much you can do. You just have to sit and wait.
Are we meant to call before we leave? Like, to make sure it's all modemed up or whatever? Or
so I've just actually...
It's not even happening if the modem wasn't on.
No, everything will run regardless of the modem.
Okay.
But I can see straight away. I was going to get to it later. But... connected, when you see a bottom, sorry, the top line there, connected IP test, blah, 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 in green, that means the connection's up. If it wasn't green, it'll be red, meaning, there's some type of issue. It could be simple as no signal. So you'll see on the side of that modem there, you'll see a signal bar, and we try and aim for about 3 bars. 4 is ideal. 3 is excellent, 2 is okay, and it'll be in red, maybe because it's probably no signal.
So
you may have to relocate that aerial in a better position. You may even have to swing it over this side. The smallest change probably would make a difference. Yeah, it's a signal aerial. Signal strength. Happy days. Done. Once it's calibrated, there's no need to
have it. So after you've done the calibration, wind in the sensor, and then go through your auto stock process. Because it's already saved those calibration values.
You take it nearly right in?
Yeah, as far as I possibly get.
Okay.
As far as I will get. All right, assuming that all your stock's back in, we're gonna do a test. They call it an auto stock, but essentially it's another word for stock tape, because we need to tell the computer what's exactly in each slot and what title it is.
So it pulls it out, scans it, puts it back in, records it, and adds it to the movie database. That's how you can select the movie and whatnot.
Oh, so that's why you don't have to worry about where you put them back in.
No, right. It's only a problem after you've stock taped and then you start moving things around.
Yeah.
When you get problems because a customer will hire something and a completely different title will come out and you get problems. So try and avoid that. Yeah, if possible. So I'm pretty sure it steps here. 108. So this is the main screen that you're presented with. We're going to go to this section here, which is the auto stock option section. Don't worry about too much about anything else. So we're going to enter a slot value. We can use this keypad here, 108. You can pretty much go to any slot you want, but in this guide, we're going to stick to what's on here. Make sure none of these check boxes are checked because we're just doing a quick test. Once we're happy with this quick test, we'll then stock take the whole machine, and that's almost at the end of the install process. All right, so I've keyed in my slot values, and we're going to hit this auto stock button. You hear it go beep, like a chirp. No crunching noises, no really bad, there's nothing out of the ordinary there. You'll know when you're hearing something bad, you'll hear like plastic crunching. yeah, which is not a good sign. So that's, you can see here, it's in the red, that's the tag number. So it's successfully recorded a tag number of the disc and put it away. And that's done that, was it four times? So generally, yeah, that's a pretty good sign of everything's good. So we're going to change these back to the original settings, which is 0, 2.9, now we must make sure that this auto start kiosk wear is checked. What that does is once that's finished stock taking by itself, it's going to load the customer screen so that people can start using the machine. What we don't want is that unchecked, and so what it does is it finishes its stock tape and it just sits here doing nothing, which is bad because no one can use it, and it'll be a call out for someone to come out and get the machine running. So we're just going to make sure that start, it's in all the steps, start kiosk where after auto stop. Alright, so going to make sure that we've got connectivity, internet. Should I run through a start command as well?
Or, yeah.
Yeah. Probably. So at this point, yeah, so this will just take probably an hour
or so. There's no need to hang around, but we want to make sure that there's an internet connection.
This is the aerial. Now, depending on the site, we normally leave this inside the cabin, but depending on like how good this phone signal is, we may have to bring it up outside and pop the roof. Get some of the cord out. The rest is up there. Most of the time, you'll notice that a lot of them are just sitting up. And that's usually enough signal to pick up some reception.
And in your instructions, you'll have this in here, just as a test. So we're gonna go to the Windows Start menu. We're gonna go to the Command Prompt, which is the little black DOS box that you see in the menu. And we're gonna type in the word ping, space. Hit enter. And all we're looking for, don't really look in it too much, we're getting a reply. So it means it's talking to the outside world and getting a reply. It comes with 100% loss here. You know, we've got a problem, but you really would have seen that because this connected IP here will be in red, which will be a connection problem. So then you may need to call support and go through it with them. Close this. Okay, so once that's going, we've locked up wound back the calibration sensor, we've put the three door lugs in, and now we just have to put the three cables back in. Pretty essential. The most essential one is the credit card reader, which takes payment, so we have to make sure that goes in, and it can be any USB slot available. Doesn't matter which USB slot, as long as it's your LED light, which is the red and the green turn light, that just indicates if it's busy or not, and that'll go in this socket here. So fourth one in from the left on the bottom row. Can only go in one way. And the door lights, which is the light up there. And that'll go in any spare socket that you have available on the back of the unit. So we've got the three cables back in. Pretty much ready to close the door. What I'm going to do is going to get the red maintenance screen. And that just puts a blank screen over it so no one can play around with any of the buttons. And it just shows people that it'll be back. Online soon. Close the door, wrap her up. Just another point is there is some variation on this power lead. Some can be quite long, and what we don't want to do is get this lead put down anywhere down here when you close the door. So just keep an eye out as you're closing the door that it doesn't go down there. That's fine where it is. So just lock the door, take the keys, take the tools.
And verify that the fluoro is on, the credit card reader is on, and the
there.
Return light's
little
on.
Where's the
laptop? That's the light.